अशोक, आर यू एबल टू हियर मी? ओके, हैव ऑल दी 37 स्टूडेंट्स ज्वाइन द मीटिंग? एवरी वन इज देयर? ओके ओके फ्रेंड्स, टुडे मिस्टर साईकांत वर्मा आईएएस इज हियर टू एड्रेस यू. बिफोर इंट्रोड्यूसिंग हिम, आई वुड लाइक टू कंग्रेचुलेट ऑल ऑफ यू वंस अगेन फॉर क्लियरिंग यूपीएससी मेन्स एग्जाम. हाउएवर फ्रेंड्स, यू नीड टू वर्क हार्ड एंड स्मार्ट टू स्कोर मोर इन द पर्सनालिटी टेस्ट, बिकॉज the range of the mocks difference would be more in the personality test than the mains. For example, if you consider the mains mocks of a 100th ranker with 600th ranker, generally the difference would not be more than 20 mocks. But in the personality test, students can get from 100 mocks to up to 220 mocks. So the range can be more than even 100 mocks. Friends, in the last few weeks, all of you have attended the mock interviews conducted by our academy, and some of you attended it more than twice. And the IAS officers who have conducted your mock interviews have given you individual feedback. Please work on them. It would definitely help you to improve your performance. Also friends, I felt that a topper of UPSC from the recent past who scored very good marks in the personality test should come and address you. That's why I invited Mr. Saikant Verma, a 2014 batch IAS officer, to address you. Previously, he worked in Microsoft and Google. Presently, he is working as Joint Collector of Kadapa District in Andhra Pradesh. Some of the students in this meeting who are from AP may be knowing Mr. Saikant Verma. He got All India Rank 18, and in the personality test, friends, he got 208 marks, which is one of the highest scores in the UPSC personality test. In the last few years, he helped several aspirants with their personality test. Particularly, for example, one of the names is Miss Nandini, who got All India First Rank in 2016. Today, Mr. Saikant Verma is here to share his ideas on how to score more in the personality test. Some of you are interviewed by him already in the last few weeks. Mr. Saikant Verma believes that one can improve their marks in the personality test by a good amount of 40 to 50 marks if they work in a specified direction in the last few weeks or 1 or 2 months before the actual personality test of UPSC. Friends, I would like to plan this session in the following way. First few minutes, Mr. Saikant Verma would tell you some strategies. He'll explain some fundamentals required for any aspirant going to personality test. He'll give you some tips, some ideas on how to score more. After that, there will be a question and answer session. In the Q&A session, all of you feel free to ask any of your doubts or queries. Okay? Okay, now Mr. Saikant Verma, Saikant, you can start now.
Hi, Sharad. Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, Saikant, I'm able to hear you. We're clear.
Okay. Thank you, Sharad, for that introduction. So, good morning, everyone. So, like I was saying, the range of marks that you get in interview is pretty wide, which is why you can score many marks. And scoring good marks in interview will make a lot of difference. You know, you need to sweat out a lot to get some, you know, 30-40 mark lead in mains. But however, if you prepare for the interview well, and if you're able to score anywhere above 200, I think you will definitely find your name in the final selection list. So, hence it is very, very important that you focus on the interview and be well prepared. In fact, the interview board expects you to come prepared. That actually shows how serious you are about this exam and about the interview that you are giving. So, and the third advantage you have got is they will not be aware of your mains marks. So it will be like a fresh start and everybody is on the same level playing ground. And it all depends on you and your performance alone, which will decide the number of marks that you would get in the interview. So if you manage to get 200 plus in your interview, you will certainly find your name in the selection list, no matter how many marks you have scored in the mains. Because the mains cutoff will be very, very close and many people will be falling in a very small range. So if you manage to get 200 plus in the interview, it means that you've already, surpassed nearly 60 to 70% of your fellow competitors who have cleared the mains. Hence, it is extremely important that you take your interview very seriously. And yes, don't be under the, I will be talking about different myths that are there in the interview regarding the interview. So one of the myths is, you cannot change your personality in a matter of one day or a few days or a week's time or a month's time. That is actually a misconception, and people use that to discourage you from preparing for the interview. Wrong. You have to be prepared for the interview, and you need to put in specific efforts. Trust me, 2 to 3 months or 1 month will make a hell lot of difference in the way you perform in your final interview. So that is a myth which I'm trying to bust right now. So please understand that, every person has an individual original personality which cannot be changed. Yes, personality cannot be changed in a few days time, but it can very well be groomed. Personality can be groomed in a matter of few days if you put deliberate efforts to it. And you can also basically be relaxed and get used to the concept of having a formal conversation. That's what it is. The interview is all about. It's more like a formal tea table conversation. Like I said, it's a formal tea table conversation. So formal, I'm stressing here because it is not a casual tea table conversation wherein you can sit any way you want, or you can get dressed in any way you want. And the way you talk is also should not be very casual. You just have to, it's more like an intellectual conversation, but in a formal way. So that is the second thing you need to keep in mind. The interview, please don't, overburden yourself with the idea that, okay, I'm now going to be judge. So have I answered this question correctly? Now, how many marks will they be awarding given the fact that I have answered this question in this particular manner and things like that? Don't let that, let those thoughts run in your mind. Just make sure that you're just having a formal conversation, intellectual conversation with people who are nothing but your seniors. You know, you aspire to become bureaucrat, and the people who would be interviewing you are administrators, bureaucrats, who have done their bit in various verticals of governance. So consider them to be your seniors. Don't be so intimidated by the fact that they are going to judge you and things like that. So that is the third point I would like to tell you. And next point is, some people say you cannot be too honest, naive and things like that. So I cannot talk about other person's perceptions and experiences, but I can definitely tell you from my little experience, anybody would appreciate an honest and a good logical conversation. So you need to be honest, and there is nothing wrong about being honest. So that is what the interview board expects. So just keep that in mind. You don't have to fake something that you're not. Don't try and be somebody that you're not. Just be casual and be honest about the answers that you give, and be sincere. Make sure that you give answers that you actually mean, rather than the answers that you actually give only with the intention of impressing somebody, because that's not going to work out. These people have spent more than 30 years of experience in governance, and they will definitely call you a bluff, because they'll be dealing with people day in and day out. So don't think you are smart enough to fool them. The whole purpose of this interview is not to fool anybody around. The purpose of the interview is to ensure that you share your opinions honestly and genuinely, and give only logical answers. Okay, don't be driven by preconceived notions and things like that, no matter however obvious they may sound. Like, for example, are women physically weak compared to men? Certainly not, because that is an answer which is driven by logic and rationale. So that is just one example that I'm giving. So don't be driven by any sort of preconceived notions. So you need to ingrain these rationale in your body and blood so much that you know your answers, they do not represent any inherent biases that you might have. And most important thing is be honest and be logical. These are the things that you need to keep in your mind while giving the interview and while preparing for the interview as well. So the next point I would like to talk about is the types of different questions that will be asked in the interview. I have largely categorized the types of questions into four. One, the questions which are related to your DAF, that is detailed application form. The second type of questions are based on current affairs, a lot of issues going on. So you may be asked to respond on some of them. And third point is traditional and static questions, like for example, you know, parliamentary system or presidential system, which is better, you know, first past the post and so on and so forth. Those are the basic traditional and static questions, which may be asked in the interview. And the fourth type of questions are, I would like to call this fourth category as GHY questions or GHY questions. What does GHY mean? It's an acronym for God help you questions. So these are the questions which you will not be able to answer. These are the questions like, what is the chemical composition of, let us say, rosewood? Or let us say, you know, what is the chemical composition of a cloud? You know, these are the questions which you will not be able to answer. But some of these questions will also be asked in the interview to, one, to check your honesty, and number two, to check how cool you can be while you are still trying to be grilled upon. So these are largely the four type of questions. So the most important thing which most of the candidates grossly undermine is the first category, that is the detailed application form based questions. So the DAF questions. So these are very, very important. You need to look at each and every word that you have written in your application form and be thoroughly be prepared about it. So how do you need to be prepared on your DAF? You take every word that you have mentioned in the application form. Let us say it should very well start with your name. Let us say your name is Subhash Chandra. So you can expect a lot of questions on Subhash Chandra Bose, or even things like, you know, what does Subhash mean? What does Chandra mean? And things like that. So you have to take every word that you mentioned in your application form and form a set of questions that can be asked from that one word. And you need to prepare an answer also. The answer that you prepare for, please understand that this is not any answer writing question wherein you write around 10-20 points. You just have to write some 3-4 points wherein your answer will not span for more than 2-5 minutes. There is no hard and fast and rule that your answer should be done in such and such time. But what I'm trying to say is be precise and brief. You don't have to go into too many details, but your answer should be logically coherent. So you need to prepare for the answer for the question that might be asked. And you should also think about what further questions can emanate from the answer that you give. I'll give you one classic example. So this happened to one of my batchmates, not me. So he's from Hyderabad, and he was asked a question in the interview. So tell me about Hyderabadi cuisine. So he mentioned about the different food items, and he spoke a little more about Hyderabadi biryani. And he ended his answer with the sentence saying that Hyderabadi biryani is so famous that it has got a geographical indicator tag. So that is where he stopped the answer. The next question was obviously on geographical indicator. So basically intellectual property questions. So in a way, he orchestrated the interview board and influenced them to ask a question in a specific direction. And it was a deliberate act. He deliberately made that statement at the end so that they can, they will be inclined towards asking questions on intellectual property, and he was very well prepared on the topic. So that is how you need to control, I mean, in a way influence the kind of questions that emanate. So it is very important that you form, you identify from everything that you've written in your DAF, see what questions can be asked on that one word, and you need to formulate the answers for each of these questions, and for every answer, what further questions can be asked. So it is like a tree that you're building. So one keyword in your DAF, multiple questions, and each question, multiple answers, and each answer, how many further new set of questions can be asked, then answers to that, and so on and so forth. You need to go to multiple levels like this till you exhaust. So that is the level of detailed preparation you need to do on your DAF, because the last thing you want to do is you not knowing things about the things that you have written in your own DAF. That I think is a big blunder, and people will also not appreciate somebody who wouldn't know their own norm. Let us say, for example, you are from Hyderabad and you don't know about Charinar history. I think it's a blunder. So don't make that mistake. Be prepared thoroughly on your DAF. Then current affairs, obviously you need to be in touch with the current affairs, what's going on, and always form opinions. As a bureaucrat, it is very important that you have a strong opinion and you make decisions. So decision making is a very, very, very important trait that you need to possess as a public servant. So they expect that to be there while they're interviewing you too. So ensure that you have an opinion driven by rock solid logic. Logic, but nothing else. Not because somebody else has opined in a specific way, not because somebody has written in a specific way. You need to be driven purely by logic. And sometimes there is no right opinion or wrong opinion. You just take your opinion driven by pure logic and you stick to it. They may try and comment, they may try and break your confidence, but if you truly believe in your decision, yes, go ahead. Like for example, during my interview, I was asked this one question. So I did my engineering from IIT Madras, and I have worked in a software company called Google. Before I gave my interview. So what they have asked is, see Sai Kant, so this is one of the board members asking me this question in the real interview. So they said, so Sai Kant, I feel that you are people like you, on whom the government of India has invested so much money in, because government spends a lot of money to run premier institutes like IITs, so that you become good engineers. But people like you, you waste all of that money and then you come into public administration. I think this is actually wastage of public resources. I think getting into civil service should be made an option after 12th standard itself, so that people can be groomed into public administration right after 12th standard, and they can be trained obviously a selection process will be there after 12th standard, and then you will be selected into the service depending on your performance, and then after selection you will be trained for 4 years or 5 years for degrees in public administration, governance, economy, and things like that, so that we can have better administrators and better utilization of government resources. What do you think? This is the question that he asked me at the outset. He's actually trying to attack me. So what I did was I smiled at him and said, I thought for a minute, I paused for a minute. I had formed a constructive answer in my mind. And then I replied back with a smile saying that, sorry, sir, I beg to differ with you, because getting into civil service is actually is a very mature decision, which I don't think a 12th standard student will be capable of making. For example, in my own case, as a 12th class student, the only thing I cared about is making money. But it is only after years that I realized that, during my graduation, that I realized that money is not everything. And money can only give satisfaction to some extent, but beyond a point, money is not going to make a lot of difference. So also I believe that a 12th standard student will not be mature enough to decide whether he can become a good administrator or not. And also the nature of the civil services that we have as of today is the very nature is that it needs people from diverse backgrounds. You know, we actually need best of the engineers coming into the service, best of the doctors, best of the lawyers, best of the MBA grads coming into the service, so that we'll be able to tackle with the various challenges which are emanating in administration day to day. So I feel that you know, selecting students into UPSC, selecting students into the services soon after 12th standard may not be appropriate. So this is the answer that I gave. And although he had countered my answer, but I can very well see it on his face that he was very contented with the answer that I gave. So this is the kind of expectation that they will have. So whatever opinion that you give, it has to be driven by logic, and you need to stand your ground. So that is why, which makes it all the more important that you don't take an opinion or take a decision in haste. Think for a minute and arrive at a decision depending on the logic alone. Because just because somebody else said it, if you say it, then they will ask you why. And not to just see yourself, it's as bad as basically you have mishandled that question, and that will backfire on you. So don't do it. And the traditional and static questions, you can figure out what these questions are by reading the interview transcripts of all toppers in the last 10 years at least. Please go through the interview transcripts. You'll find a lot of them on the internet. Do that.
One minute. So I think now everyone is able to see the Sai Kantharma, right? Garima, are you able to see?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Okay.
Yeah, so the fourth category of questions is the guy question, that is God help you questions. So the idea for these questions is, think for a minute. If you know the answer, say the answer. If you don't know the answer, tell them, sorry sir, I don't know, or sorry ma'am, I don't know the answer. And there is nothing wrong in saying I don't know for some questions that you don't know an answer for. You know, first question, everybody will be happy to say I don't know. Second question, I don't know, you will say. Third question, you will start fidgeting. So don't do that. It doesn't matter how many random questions that are asked at you. If you don't know something, please be as confident in saying, sorry, sir, I don't know, as you would for your first question that you don't know the answer for. So please ensure that you be confident, never lose your cool. And no, don't hesitate in saying that you don't know the answers for something that you really don't know. One more thing I'd like to reiterate here is, a smart person is not someone who knows everything. There is nobody in this whole wide world who knows everything. But a smart person is someone who knows what he knows and who doesn't, and who knows what he doesn't know. So if I ask you where is, let us say, Eiffel Tower, if you know the answer, you will say, yes sir, it is in Paris, France. If you don't know the answer, you should be spontaneous enough to say, sorry sir, I don't know. Don't be like, Eiffel Tower is somewhere in Europe, but I don't know exactly where it is. Don't do that nonsense. So it'll be very irritating, because one, you will be consuming their time, and number two, at the end of the day, you don't know the answer. So you need to have that clarity of thought, whether you know the answer for that question or you don't know the answer for that question. As simple as that. Don't try and waste their time, waste your time, and more importantly, their time. So that is about the fourth type of question. And the last point I would like to tell is, please go through the interview transcripts, and also on YouTube you will find a lot of interviews of, you know, retired or serving bureaucrats. Look at their interviews and then see how they are responding to questions. There is one specific interview that I would all suggest you to watch. It is the interview of Anil Swarup while he was serving as coal secretary. You can find it on YouTube. So the reason why I'm asking you to look at this specific interview is, the interviewer, he basically tried to grill Mr. Anil Swarup And you should look at the way he's calm, composed, always smiling, and you know, taking the questions and answering them purely by logic and with that level of maturity. I think that is what is expected of you guys. Remember that you need to walk in as an IAS officer to be able to walk out as one. If you want to become an IPS officer, you should be able to walk into that interview room as an IPS officer so that you will be able to walk out as one. So what I mean by that is you need to walk into the interview room as an IAS officer already. You should you know, you need to think like an IAS officer, you need to speak like an IAS officer, you need to behave like an IAS officer for you to be able to actually become one. So interview is not something wherein you walk in as an aspirant and you walk out as an IAS officer. No, you should walk in as an IAS officer to be able to walk out as one. That is the kind of expectation that the board has got. So I will stop here at this point of time and I will take any questions. I can do this till 11:55 because I have another meeting scheduled at 12 o'clock. So I can do it till 11:55. So if you have got any questions or any clarifications that you want that you seek from me, you may ask the questions. I'll be able to respond.
Sir, may I ask?
Yeah, Garima, please go ahead.
So, sir, there are certain issues on which we read different types of opinions. And sometimes it becomes, sir, for example, a question that's usually asked from candidates of political science and international relations is, do you think India's closeness with US is hurting India's relations with China, with Russia? Mm. And so we have content on both, whether it's hurting, whether the relations are improving, or whether India should maintain its relations with Russia. So, sir, what should be the opinion on that? Because
what is your opinion on it?
So, sir, there are both positives and negatives. And I'm not able to decide. So
this is what I have told you, Garima, very clearly. As a bureaucrat, you need to make decisions. Okay? This is not mathematics that you're dealing with, wherein you're right or wrong. There's a lot of gray area. Okay? So, opinions do matter. You have to take a stance. Once you become an IAS officer, you know, you need to make decisions, and the decisions will involve both pros and cons of anything that you take. So depending on the circumstances, you will have to arrive at a decision. So what I would tell you is, yes, for any specific question, not just the example that you gave, anything, there are both pros and cons, and you are free to choose any specific stance. And most of the times, both stances are correct. So it is up to you as to you as an individual, you need to form an opinion of your own, and you should be able to appreciate why you have taken that particular stance driven by logic. So it is up to you whether, you know, which way you go about. But if you were to ask me, I would say no, our closeness relations with any country for that matter, not just US, I don't think will have an effect. Obviously, will have some effect, but that will not define the relationship between any other two economies. We have been right from the beginning are very clear. We always deal with our relations with the country on mutual grounds. We do not approach one country because we want to send some sort of a message to other country. That is the whole concept of, you know, non-interference in our foreign policy. We deal with whatever dealings we have with India, US. They are meant for India and US, whatever is best for India and US. Whatever relations we have with India and Russia is only meant to have, you know, it only means what sort of relation that, what is best for India and Russia. So that is the whole concept of our foreign policy ever since our independence. So the non-interference concept and the non-alignment, which our country has been showing right from the beginning, even during the Cold War days, it only reiterates that.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, any other questions?
Hello, sir.
Yes, Sahitya.
Yes, sir. So I have two questions. The first question is, there are certain times when they ask, introduce yourself to the board. So in such kind of questions, is it okay if we not mention any personal qualities of us? That is, they sometimes ask, there are certain candidates who reply that I am so-and-so, let's suppose I'm enthusiastic or determined. I personally do not like to introduce in that way, but I have one idea, sir. That is, I have this idea of, I wish to say that I really enjoy good conversations as much as I enjoy a good self-introspection. Is it okay to say like that, or is it something which is a little over the top?
Sahitya, why do you think they will ask the question of, please introduce, tell me about yourself sort of a question? What does the interviewer want to know? You tell me.
So they obviously do not want to know what is already there in the DAF. They want to know a little personal side of yours, along with yours. And apart from that, they want to get a hint of.
Okay, so I'll give you the answer straight, Sahitya. The reason why they will ask that question is because, yes, they may have the DAF in front of them, but they will not come prepared. It's not like they will, some of them do, but not necessarily everybody does. So when they ask you to, tell me about yourself, just tell them about yourself, your background, your educational background, your work ex. Don't talk too much about, I am an aspirant man, I do this, these are the traits I have, these are my strengths, weaknesses. I would personally not prefer saying all of those things. I would rather stick to, I'm so and so, I'm from this, this is my background, educational background, this is my work ex, and that's it. If they want to know more, they will ask it further. I think it's better that you keep it simple and short.
Yes. And the second question that I have
One more thing is, see, the interviewers, when they ask you a question, they actually mean that question. They don't expect any, hidden things in the question. They will not try and, overcomplicate stuff. They actually, when they ask you a question, they actually mean to ask that question only, and they expect the answer for that and that question alone. Okay, so you don't have to overcomplicate it. Just answer to the point, precise and logic.
Sure, sir. And the last question is, for example, if they ask, how has the government handled the second wave of corona? And there are certain lapses on the part of government. So how best can we defend our answer without being too much critical?
Yeah, I personally also feel that definitely the government has failed in the way it has handled the pandemic, but it is now trying in its every way possible to handle it. So there is nothing wrong in criticizing the government, but it has to be a constructive criticism, and you need to tell them, how we as a country, how the government is now making efforts to make it right, and now how it is, probably India, on the other hand, is the only country which has taken up the largest vaccination program ever in the whole wide world, isn't it? And it's for the COVID-19 pandemic. And we were one of the very first countries to have introduced the vaccination. So, there are certain measures which the government has also taken to prevent the second wave of pandemic. But yes, there are certain lapses. There's nothing wrong in criticizing the government about it, but don't be overcritical about it. Just make a balanced answer, give a balanced answer, and then you point out what are all the measures that are also being taken now, which you think will be able to control the pandemic.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, anybody else? So I have 6 more minutes to go.
Friends, you can feel free. Some of you may be thinking that this may be a silly question to ask to Sai Khan, so let us not ask. Don't think like that. Okay? Don't think whether it is silly to others or not. Think whether you really have that question in the mind or not. If you have the question in the mind, just ask it. Though it is a public platform, just don't think about that. So go ahead and ask your doubts.
I guess there are no.
Hello, sir.
Hello. Yeah,
hello, sir. Sir, my question is, what is the proper dress code, sir, for interview?
Formals. For guys, it is a full sleeve shirt, at least with a necktie. Then trousers, you need to tuck in your shirt and wear a proper formal belt.
Anand, please mute. Anand, please mute. After ask the question, please mute. Okay, sir, I can continue.
Formal shoes, socks, and if you're comfortable wearing a blazer, please do. Any other questions?
Sir, good morning, sir. I'm Dinesh.
Yeah, good morning.
Sir, earlier I had worked as assistant with police department in Tamil Nadu, sir. I worked for about 2 months and then I resigned. And presently, before 2 years, I got selected as assistant commandant in CRPF, which I have not joined, but I had asked for extension. So generally, when I face any interview board, there is a question like, so you have wasted one person's opportunity in government sector, and similarly, you have been extending your duration for joining the CRPF as well. So they generally try to stress like, are you lackadaisical in joining like that? So how should we confront such kind of questions, sir?
Why do you think, so you tell me, why have you done this? Why did you extend your joining?
Sir, last year I got selected and to write this year preliminary examination, I extended it, sir. And
I thought you must give. See, there's nothing wrong in being honest, Dinesh. I'll tell you, in my interview, when I first walked in, one of the members looked at my DAF and said, oh, you worked in Google. What have you been doing for the last 2 years? The chairman of my interview board had asked me this question. As I was just, I just sat down and this is the first thing they have asked me. I said, I've been preparing. So I quit my job in 2013 June to prepare for this exam. And I was giving the interview sometime in March of 2015. So that was my first attempt. So the interview chairman asked me, what was I doing in the last 1.5 years? I said, I was preparing for this exam. And one of the other board members, he started commenting, I don't know why you people waste so much of time for this exam. You know, it's nothing but 1.5 years wastage of time, this, that, and all. You know, I had expected that question, but they didn't ask me to respond. Had they asked me to respond, I would have responded. I would have told them, yes, this is a competitive exam and I want to make sure that I give my best. My first preference is obviously to get into this service. And but as any career backup, I wanted to keep that as my career backup. And I have gotten that opportunity. And I want to first try to clear this particular exam. And if I can clear this exam, I will take this job. Otherwise, that serves as my career backup and I will definitely go and join back CRPF. That would be my answer. There's nothing wrong about it. Just try and be honest about it and be confident. Don't lose your confidence. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Anybody else? Okay, so I guess that's it. Sharad, can we conclude?
Okay, Saigan, thank you for now spending your valuable time. So let us end the session now.
Thank you all and I wish you all the very best.